In this video, I'm going to discuss with you how to feed pollen substitutes. But before I get into it, I need to deal with a little bit of the semantics associated with pollen substitutes. Some folks will call them pollen substitutes, others will call them supplements, and often they have two very different definitions. So I'll give you definition one, give you definition two, let you make up your mind on how you want to discuss them, and then I'll tell you how I'm going to talk about them. So in definition one, you've got a pollen substitute and a pollen supplement. The substitute, according to some folks, would be used when there is no pollen coming in from outside the nest. So you're substituting a type of protein. A supplement then would be there's low quality or just a little bit of pollen coming in from outside the nest, so that patty exists to supplement. Now there's another group of beekeepers who would argue that the words supplement in a pollen patty means that the patty itself has pollen in it. It has been supplemented with pollen. Whereas a substitute has no pollen in it, so it's completely substituting pollen. I really don't care which one you use or which one you may think is right or wrong. For purposes of discussion in this video, I'm simply going to say pollen sub or pollen patty. I hear more often pollen sub. So why am I talking about this in the first place? Well, when bees need carbohydrates, you know, nectar or honey, and there is no nectar coming in from which to make honey, you can remedy that by feeding bees sugar syrup, either sucrose in the form of granulated sugar that has been dissolved in water, or high fructose corn syrup. So feeding bees when there are nectar deficiencies or not enough stored honey is a really easy thing to do. But what about when there are pollen deficits or low quality pollen coming in from the environment? What do you do in those contexts? Well, many beekeepers, especially commercial beekeepers, will try to get their colonies to do things that colonies ordinarily wouldn't do certain times of the year, or they try to replace a low quality pollen or no pollen at all by feeding bees pollen subs. What is a pollen sub? Well, different manufacturers have different ingredients that essentially go into these solid pollen patties, but they're all based on a few basic premises. If bees get protein from pollen and vitamins and minerals and nutrients and lipids and other types of things that they need for the health of themselves as well as the colony, then a pollen sub needs to replace this. So a pollen sub will usually have a lot of some sort of protein in it, you know, egg white protein or soy protein, things such as that. So it's a protein powder base with other ingredients that go into it. A lot of manufacturers consider those ingredients proprietary, so you may not even know what's going into it. And of course, a pollen sub is capped off at the top with a lot of sugar because the manufacturers need the bees to want to eat this stuff. And so there'll be a lot of sugar in pollen subs. And the idea is that you administer these pollen subs to colonies when colonies have no pollen available to them or low quality pollen available to them, or some mix of the two. Maybe you're getting good pollen, but it's only a small amount. So beekeepers will judge the pollen landscape, as it were, and say, according to their management practices, I want my colonies to be growing now. I want to be able to split my colonies in 2 weeks. I want to be able to produce a lot of brood or maybe get them ready for the honey flow and there's no pollen coming in or low quality pollen coming in. So those commercial beekeepers or other beekeepers may say then, in order to get the colonies to do something they're not ordinarily doing because of the lack of pollen or quality pollen, I'm going to provide that for them. I'm going to use a pollen sub. So you can purchase these pre-made from manufacturers. They will come in patties, usually with a Play-Doh or modeling clay-like consistency. Or you can purchase it in powder form and follow the ingredients on the package, and that will usually tell you to mix it with some sort of sugar syrup to make that pliable patty that you can administer to colonies. So when might you consider applying a pollen sub to a colony? Well, you might do it when there's restricted flight. Maybe the weather's bad, a lot of rain, or it's cold, or it's very hot, and the bees can't go out and collect pollen. You might also consider doing it if you've got a weak colony that just needs that extra push to get it to go out of whatever slump it's in. Maybe it's battling a disease or a pest, or there was a poor queen that you've had to requeen and you need it to grow. Again, maybe there's low amounts of pollen coming in or low quality pollen. These are all things that cause beekeepers to want to administer pollen subs in the first place. There's really two ways that you can administer pollen subs to colonies. If you think about the way that you can purchase it from the manufacturer, either as a patty or as a powder, then you can intuitively figure out the two ways to administer them to colonies. You can administer them as patties, or you can administer them as powder. So let's go the patty route first, because this is by far the most common way that I see beekeepers do this. Pollen subs, pollen patties, are pancake-sized, pliable protein, vitamin, mineral, nutrient sources that are best placed immediately on top of the brood nest. So if you've got a single hive body, that's your entire hive, you would remove the lid from that hive. You would place a spacer on the upper rim of that box, and then you would add the patty. Let's talk a little bit about this spacer. This spacer is essentially a 3/4 inch piece of wood that goes around the edge of the brood box. And what that does is that spacer will create a distance between the upper part of the frames of the brood box and whatever goes on top of the brood box, either a lid if you've got a single, or multiple supers depending on if you've got double brood boxes or medium supers. So this spacer, as the name implies, creates a space between the bottom box and whatever goes above it so that you can put that patty and not have to squish it between the lid of the box and the brood box or between two different boxes of that hive. Why is that important? Well, if you live in an area where small hive beetles are present, small hive beetles love pollen subs. They love pollen patties. They'll go into those patties, they'll lay eggs, their offspring, the larvae will consume those patties, and you can get explosive small hive beetle reproduction. This is especially true if you squish those pollen subs between the lid and the brood box or between multiple supers. If you do that, what you're doing is creating spaces around that sub that the bees cannot access, but that the beetles can. So that spacer creates enough space around the sub so that bees have complete access to that patty and can patrol it and keep small hive beetles away. So if you live in an area where small hive beetles are present, you want to use that spacer so that you can give ample room to administer that pollen sub. If you don't live in an area where small hive beetles are present, then you can put those patties on top of the frames of the brood box and return the lid or return the supers. Even then, I prefer to use that spacer because it gives you a little bit of room to work and it keeps that patty from getting squished up into the frames in the uppermost box or adhering to the lid or ending up where you don't want it. So adding that spacer, adding the patty, and then returning the lid or the upper boxes is a really good way to get patties directly to that colony. And depending on the colony's response to the patty, you may need to feed again in a week or 2 weeks or 3 weeks or 4 weeks, again, depending on what you're trying to get out of that colony. You'll stop feeding patties when you see ample amounts of pollen coming in from the environment. You can see those bees foraging at the nest entrance with pollen loads on their hind legs. Then you know that there's enough in the environment for the bees to do what they need, so I don't need to administer patties. The second way to get that pollen sub to colonies is through the dry form, and this is increasingly popular. Remember, you can purchase dry substitute from beekeeping equipment supply companies. It usually comes in large bags, like it looks like a dog food bag. You open that bag, it's just full of powder. It gives you instructions on how to make it into a patty, but if you elect not to make it into a patty, you can put that dry sub in the apiary and give bees access to it, and they will collect it. You'll see them foraging on the powder, packing it on their hind legs like pollen, and flying it back to the nest. The thing that you need to remember in this context is you've got to put out just enough pollen sub to get them there, but you don't want to put out too much, especially if you live in a humid environment, because it will clump up, it'll be difficult for the bees to access. You need to protect it from the rain, so you might have some lid over it, you might put it under an overhang or a carport nearby the apiary. You have to protect that sub from the elements because that powder will begin to cake and make it difficult for the bees to forage. Now I need to spend some time talking about whether or not you should feed subs in any context. This is an incredibly important question, and we're right now on the edge of understanding this well. It's very common, especially in commercial beekeeper operations here in the US and other places around the world, to feed pollen substitutes. You see it all the time. A lot of commercial beekeepers have their own recipes that they mix up and administer their colonies, and they swear they work, or they trade recipes with other commercial beekeepers. My team and I and other researchers around the world have done a lot of research on pollen sub, and it's very common in the literature, in the research literature, to find that a particular study showed no impact on the pollen sub in a colony at all. Sometimes you see more brood, sometimes you see less brood. Sometimes you see more bees or less bees, and there's this whole cascade of things that have been measured, with some of them positive, some of them neutral, and some of them negative. So what I usually tell people when it comes to the science of pollen subs is the jury is very much still out. What do I mean by that? So let me break it down into the best possible advice I can give you. Most hobbyist beekeepers will never need to feed a pollen sub. You've got a low density of colonies. You usually have enough available in the environment for the bees to do whatever it is they need to do based on the time of year. I usually recommend that hobbyist beekeepers not worry about administering pollen subs. Commercial beekeepers, on the other hand, keep bees in high densities. They often move them to locations where there's not available pollen, or maybe it's not available right now, but it's coming in a few weeks, or the pollen quality is low, and they feel that it's necessary in these circumstances to feed pollen subs. I usually tell commercial beekeepers, just do what you normally do, but it would be really good to have a small group of colonies off to the side that you don't feed pollen sub, so that you can compare how they respond to the ones that are actually receiving pollen sub. And you may surprise yourself and see that there's not differences in the response of colonies. I've got commercial beekeepers who swear by them. I've got commercial beekeepers who say they don't use them. I've had colleagues and scientists who swear by them, and colleagues and scientists who say the data don't support their use. So my recommendation usually is hobbyists don't need to worry about it. Commercial beekeepers, keep doing what you feel is best based on what other commercial beekeepers are saying in the area. I will say nutrition research from pollen supplementation represents one of the greatest opportunities currently in the honeybee world. The ability to improve honeybee health through the formulation of products that unequivocally help bees is waiting to be done by prospective graduate students or scientists around the world. It's an exciting time to be in pollen sub research, but as a result of all of that, the recommendations that we can make generally are very clouded because of the research literature that we see. I will say, when pollen subs work in research, it's almost always because natural pollen has been added to those pollen subs. So if you want to use pollen subs and feel like you need to use them, consider mixing in some natural pollen, because all the evidence suggests that really helps colonies use it and you get out of it what you're hoping to get out of it in the first place. If you follow these basic recommendations, you can ensure that your colonies have ample pollen resources available. I'll throw on one more piece of advice. You don't just have to feed pollen subs. Some beekeepers will hold back frames of pollen in times of copious amounts of pollen. Keep those frames in the freezer so that when there's a pollen dearth, they can thaw out those frames and return those frames to the nest. Whatever you do to manage pollen availability in your colonies, make sure you do it with your eyes wide open and with the health of your colonies always at the forefront of the decisions that you're making.